Hello, today is the first, the last day of this ranked season. It's the last day. Tomorrow we will have a brand new season, which means all the ranks will reset and we will have to start climbing on the ladder again, starting from Platinum. So today I want to talk a bit about some different tier 1 and tier 2 decks that I have been using, both playing with and playing against on the ladder in best of 1, and talk a bit about these decks that I have in mind, about their strengths and weaknesses, and how can we consider to use them in the new season starting from tomorrow. So I'm gonna talk about 6 decks. I have split them in tier 1 and tier 2 according to my understanding, and there are 3 decks that I consider tier 1 in best of 1 and 3 that I consider tier 2 but still very viable options. Standard is quite open right now, so of course there might be some other decks that are viable apart from the ones that we are gonna talk about today, but these are the ones that are both among the most popular options that we are likely to face or play ourselves, and they have proven themselves with kind of consistent results, so we are gonna focus on them primarily. I'm gonna start with the tier 1 decks, which the first one, first and foremost, we are gonna talk about mono red. As you see, this is the list I think is probably the one that I have settled right now for mono red, which has always been a tier 1 and very very dangerous deck in best of 1. Mono red is always there and remains one of the most popular choices, because it has a decent win rate, it has a very proactive game plan that punishes stumbles very much, and most importantly can help us play many games very quickly, whether win or lose, which means that we can put so many games under our belt and thus rank up quickly, especially since the deck has a decent win rate. So the list we are playing here, I will talk about some of the choices that that are not so straightforward. For example, I will start with a 2-drop slot. Here we have 4 Robber of the Rich, 4 Imrok Knight and 1 Kargan Intimidator. After I have played the deck quite a lot in the past few months, I think this is the configuration of the 2-drops that is the strongest pretty much right now. I have played even with 4 Kargan Intimidators for quite some time, but the card is a bit actually just dies a lot either to opponents Bonecrusher Giants. It's just too fragile of a card and doesn't provide doesn't provide any bonus that the turn it comes into play, while Rimrock Knight can be used as a way for our creatures to punch through bigger blockers or as a shock to the opponent's face to do additional damage. And of course Robber of the Rich has haste, or sometimes, especially when we are on the play, it can help us cast cards from the opponent's deck. So I believe these two drops, Rimrock Knight and Robber of the Rich, are stronger than the Intimidator there, and that's why we have this split. But we play just a singleton Intimidator in order to fill our curve, because since we are running only 8 one drops as well, it's very important to curve out before we play one of our three drops. So having 9 threats to deploy on the board is, I think, it's a very good number. And in addition to that, we have the option, of course, to cast a Bonecrusher Giant as a removal spell, but that's not always ideal, especially when we play against slower removal spell heavy decks that don't deploy a creature on turn 2. So we would rather just put another body on the battlefield instead of just using the giant, the stomp part of the giant on the second turn. Then the 1-drop slot is very straightforward. I mean, Fervent Champion and Akum Hellhound, I think, are the right 2-drops to play, 1-drops to play, and I think that's the right number as well. We don't want to go into playing more 1-drops because they are quite mediocre. For example, I have seen some lists play cards like Fireblade Charger, which is pretty much decent against against other decks that have some one toughness creatures, or Weaselback Redcap, which I believe is a pretty weak card, although it's a knight and synergizes a bit with Fervent Champion. Also help us put some bodies in the early game to enable Embercleave faster. But I think these are pretty weak cards, and I wouldn't like to add any more one drops to my deck if they are not strong enough cards like the two we have here. The Hellhound, which can attack from two starting on turn two, and the Fervent Champions, of course, which is the best one drop that Mono Red has at its disposal right now. In order to complement the one drop slot, we are running a three shocks, which are okay in some matchups and mediocre in others. The reason we run them is just to sometimes when we don't have a one drop, it's a decent alternative to just keep up shock. And in matchups in aggressive mirrors where when we are on the draw, it's quite good to have a shock in our hand, where we would like to just play a shock instead of deploying an one drop, for example, if we play against the mirror. The three drop slot is just the four Bone Crusher Giant and four Anax, which is very straightforward and essential for the deck. And then we run three Phoenix of Ash, because this card is one of the cards out of Mono Red that punishes the Rogue strategy pretty well. And it comes as a decently sized evasive hasty threat, which is important against decks that try to clean our board as well. Also can be used as a mana sink, because as you see we are running 20 lands plus for Shatterskull Smashing, which can be up to 24 land count. So the Phoenix plus the Castle Embereth can help us mitigate any flood issues the deck may have. And the reason we run 24 lands is because we have, as we said, some mana sinks like Phoenix of Ash. Also very important is to try to hit a land drop as often as possible to make our Akum Hellhound being able to attack, otherwise it's just a dead card. So this version of Mono Red, in order to maximize these cards, it uses 24 lands essentially. Although Shatterskull Smashing occasionally can be used as a removal spell for small creatures if we really need to. So Phoenix of Ash is the three Phoenix of Ash is the point I'm right now in the build, according to the metagame, which has a lot of rogues, and also decks, as we said, that they try to empty our board, against which Phoenix is pretty good. Phoenix is a bit less good against decks that also get on the board and try to race, because it's a pretty weak attacker in the mid game. So it's pretty much a resilient threat that it's not so favorable in races. But with the metagame being as it is right now, especially with rogues pretty much requiring most decks to have a good escape option in their deck, I think 3 Phoenix is the way to go. And then our top end is 3 Embercleave and 2 Torbrands. This is kind of a flexible split. I have seen some people could play 3 Embercleave, 3 Torbrand, or 4 Embercleave, 2 Torbrand. In this version we are running 3 and 2 because one of the slots that would probably go to the 4th Embercleave is taken by Phoenix of Ash. I explained why Phoenix of Ash is important, I believe is important in the metagame right now. But if we see some shifts, some minor shifts in the metagame, let's say we face rogues less frequently, or we are facing more decks that that want to come to go into the board as well, like for example more Yorion decks or that have sorcery speed removal only, or and the removal is mostly exile, so Phoenix of Ash is not ideal there, or we see more decks like Gruul dominate best of one, then I could see just running 2 Phoenix of Ash and going to the full 4 Embercleave, which of course is a very important card. Just right now, for the reasons described, I think we can go down to 3, because if opponents' decks are trying to kill our creatures all the time, then especially having a second copy of Embercleave is super awkward and will lead to just automatic losses. So as long as the metagame remains removal heavy, we are gonna be running 3 Embercleave and 3 Phoenix. If this shifts, we are gonna just very easily go up to the 4th Embercleave. Finally, Torbrand is a very nice card to have access to. The top end is pretty much occupied by these two cards, and I believe that 2 Torbrand is a very decent number. It can help our smaller creatures punch through opponents' blockers. It's very good after a Wrath, if the opponent Wrathed while we have an Anax on board, and works as well very nice with our burn spells like Bonecrusher Giant and Shock, making them very lethal actually. And the mana base, finally we have 16 mountains and 4 castles. Very important. The castle can win games when it just helps us push for the remaining points of damage in quite a few games. And of course we need 16 mountains to make sure we have to have about 90% chance to have one in our opening hand, so our castle embers will come untapped. And of course 4 Shatterskull Smashing, which is a decent spell land, can help us have a spell if we are flooding badly, and increases the chance that we are that we will hit land drops while we run the Akum Hellhound. Bonus points, it had happened in one game that and it won me the game, is if we have a Torbran and we untap with it, then Shatterskull Smashing becomes very insane, because just for 4 mana it can deal 3 damage to up to 2 target to up to 2 creatures or planeswalkers of the opponent, so that's extremely lethal combination with Torbran. Although of course it wouldn't come very frequently, but it's a nice option to have in our mind. Let's move to the next tier 1 deck that I would really very seriously consider playing in the competitive best of 1 format. This one is Gruul, stranger to nobody pretty much. Gruul is a very strong deck. It performed greatly in the MPL weekend, with the top competitor being Ray Sato, having a record of 10-1 in best of 3, of course, but still it still means a lot about a deck's power if you can go 10-1 in the MPL League with an aggressive deck like Gruul. And here we see the version I believe it's I would use for best of 1. As you can see, it's a bit more focused on having more threats, and one main difference that Sato was not using is that we have the Rimrock Knights here. I think the Rimrock Knights are kind of important in Gruul, especially in best of 1 where we want to have an aggressive focused game plan. It's a nice 2 drop to deploy on turn 2, it's a hard attacker that can attack through or trade with most of the opponent's blockers, or hit for a lot if the opponent just doesn't have blockers and just tries to remove our board. Pretty much it asks for removal because it will keep attacking for 3. Also, it works very well with Embercleave, which of course Gruul is also an Embercleave deck, because the pump bonus is very important, especially when we have very huge creatures like Lovestruck Beast, Kazandu Mammoth, or even Brushfire Elemental. A pump of 2 power when we are about to Embercleave one of these threats is gonna create, like, with an Embercleave 4 more damage, which is very crucial in many cases. And finally, the Dwarf ups our adventure creature count in order for our innkeeper to be stronger. Many lists don't run the Rimrock Knight, so they have only 8 adventure cards, Bonecrusher Giant and Lovestruck Beast, which of course is viable. You could run some other 2 drops like more Robber of the Reeds, more Scavenging Ooze, or you can run some Questing Beast as well. But I think probably the Rimrock Knight is worth to be played for me, and for the reasons I described. Again, is a nice proactive threat to further the aggressive plan of the deck, and makes our innkeeper quite a bit better as well, as helping it when we curve turn 1 innkeeper, and then we can play immediately an adventure creature and draw a card, while the other versions that don't run Rimrock Knight don't have the option, and give the opponents more time to just deal with the innkeeper before we can get value out of it. We can see that any version of Gruul adventure decks runs all these 12 creatures, Bonecrusher Giant, Lovestruck Beast, Kazandu Mammoth. These are very important and powerful 3 drops that can play both attack and defense. Okay, the Mammoth is better on attack of course, but it's also a land and improves the consistency of the deck. So definitely very crucial 12 slots there. Then we have the 4 Brushfire Elemental, which are very good at pushing through small blockers. Also, they can grow very much with our landfall ability when we can play a land on most of our turns. And if it's Fabled Passage, it can attack for 5 on the same turn. It comes with haste, which is pretty impressive. The other 2 drops we are running is Scavenging Ooze, 3 copies, and Robber of the Reeds. Now, Scavenging Ooze is a great Magic the Gathering card in general. I wouldn't imagine any any green deck, any green creature deck would almost always want to run a few copies of Scavenging Ooze, and this deck is no exception. We are running many creatures, and the opponent is likely to start killing our creatures, or all creatures are gonna be trading in combat. And in this type of matchups in the mid game and later, Scavenging Ooze is a great threat. It can double as a graveyard hate card against important decks like Rogues or Kroxa decks, so definitely a crucial threat to have access. And Robber of the Rich is a bit more medium in this deck, that's why we are running only two, because it's much better on the play, and it's not an adventure creature pretty much, it doesn't synergize with the deck though that great, but we need a few more 2-drops, so I would guess, and have a high creature count as well, so I guess a couple of copies of Robber of the Rich are always good. And the card is always strong enough that sometimes, especially on the play, it can just carry the game by itself. Our top end is split between 3 Embercleave and 1 Great Hands. Again, I'm running 3 Embercleave, and I think it's even more correct in this version compared to Mono Red, because here we have access to some card draw from Edgewall Innkeeper, so we are more likely to see at least 1 Embercleave compared to the Mono Red version. So I believe running 3 will just have us very good chances to just see 1 that we would really need in most games. And then we run 1 Great Hands, which is an amazing card in general. I know the deck is not so grindy and wants to be on the aggressive side, but Great Hands is such a good card and carries out very well from our 3-drops, Kazandu Mammoth and Lovestruck Beast. Plus it provides us a huge bonus in if we cast it early in the game. And then we have a very high creature count in order to take a very big advantage of its power. Finally, we run 1 Primal Might as an additional removal. Now, this card is a strong card, but we don't run more because of its sorcery speed and because we want our deck to have a high creature count and be as focused as possible. Pretty much, I don't want to commit so many slots to removal that are not creatures as well, like Bone Crusher Giant. But it can be handy in many cases, and I would really like to have access to this effect as well. And then we run 1 of Clothis, as this card is pretty much comes into play because it's a really hard to answer threat that puts the opponent on a clock. And many of the top tier threat decks right now use the graveyard, and Clothis is very good against them. One of them being Rogues, where we can exile both cards from our graveyard to decrease the number of cards we have, or even exile the creatures from the opponent's graveyard so they can return them with Agadim's Awakening, Lurrus, or Call of the Death Dweller. So Clothis as an one-off is a good metagame option, even though it's mostly a sideboard card in the best of three version. I think running one even in best of one is justified for now. The mana base looks like we have 21 lands. But actually, with the additional 4 Shatterskull Smashings plus the 4 Kazandu Mammoth, it ups the count up to 29 if needed, which will make it very unlikely that we will miss land drop, and also keep our strong landfall creatures rolling. We don't run any Evolving Wilds. I really don't like that card in aggressive strategies. I understand why people run it just to abuse landfall, but I'm not gonna put Evolving Wilds in an aggressive deck. The mana base is already bad enough. We don't run any tap lands if possible. That's why we don't also run any Temple of Abandon, and that's why we don't run Evolving Wilds either. And then of course we have the 4 Shatterskull Smashing here, which is a pretty low cost to put in most red decks, and help a deck like Gruul even more, because it's a deck that suffers very much both from threat of flooding and getting screwed. So Shatterskull Smashing and in general spell lands are very important here to increase the consistency of the deck and double as removal spell. As you have seen, we don't want to commit many creature slots to play just traditional removal, because we want to have as high creature count as possible and have a focused proactive game plan. So we are gonna move now to the third deck that I consider being tier 1, so definitely a very strong choice. This one is the Rogue strategy. The Rogue deck is also a very popular deck on the ladder. I have been facing it quite frequently while playing any deck pretty much. Is a quite popular choice for best of one. for best of three as well, but even best of one, it's a very common deck that you see a lot. And this is the version I prefer. Now, this is not exactly a traditional version we see so many times. It has a few twinges according to pretty much suit the best of one metagame a bit better. As you can see, the main card that stands out of this version is Vantress Gargoyle. Vantress Gargoyle is a very good both a flexible threat both in attack and defense. It's a huge flying body and gets benefited very much from the from executing the strategy that Rogues want to do, pretty much fill the opponent's graveyard. So it in this deck it has the maximum chances than in any other deck that it will be able both to attack and block, which is very potent for a 2-mana 5/4 flyer. And can help play defense in the early game or even close the game when the opponent has a full graveyard quite quickly, being a 5 power evasive attacker. I like this card as a way to stabilize and put a brick wall on the opponent's aggressive creatures, like that are very relevant in best of one. It's very good against mono red, good against Gruul, so it can prove its weight very much in both sides of the board. One weakness of this card is that it's actually an artifact creature, so if the opponent is running Gem Razors, then this card becomes a liability because it's the only target that could be destroyed by the Gem Razor, while we have no other artifacts and enchantments in the deck. So this could be a blowout, but the Gem Razor stock has decreased quite a bit, so I don't expect to face it very frequently. Plus, in the matchups pretty much where the opponent doesn't run Gem Razor, the Gargoyle would be a very potent threat, so I'm willing to take the risk of getting blown out once in a while if the opponent is running the Gem Razors. We have the standard creature count here. We have the Foreshoring Thief and Thief's Guild Enforcer. These are the most powerful, the main ways why we are playing Rogues. And then we have four Ruin Crabs instead of the other flying rogue creature. I will just have a quick look to find the name of this, but you get the point. I mean, it's the 1-mana 1/1 flying rogue that mills for 1 when it hits the opponent. Yes, Merfolk Windrobber. Most lists that play rogues, they usually have 3 or 4 copies of this card, but I believe I just want to pretty much mill the opponent as soon as possible, and I believe the crab is doing much better job than the Windrobber in this regard. The Windrobber just mills 1 card per turn if it connects, which is not ideal, while the Ruin Crab can mill for 3 as long as we play a land. Also, it's a decent blocker, being an 0-3 body, which is also always relevant in best of one when we are facing early attackers from the opponent. I know the Windrobber has good synergy with cards like Lurrus, and of course is a good attacker that can help mill the opponent with Soaring Thought Thief and replace itself in the late game, but I believe the creatures we are running now are more important, at least in best of one. For example, you could run it instead of Vantress Gargoyle, but then you lose a lot of the blocking power of the deck, so that's why we're rolling the specific 16 creatures. The removal suit is Bloodshifters plus Heartless Act, in addition to, four Drown in the Lock, which can be both a removal spell and a counter spell. It's pretty much the best card in the deck and one of the main reasons why we run it. These cheap removal are very potent and make sure that the opponent wouldn't get too far ahead on board. Plus, they don't require a lot of mana, so we can easily double spell with this deck and get ahead ourselves. The counter spell of choice to complement Drown in the Lock is Didn't Say Please. Now, this could be it's a flexible slot. You can use some different options in this slot. Some of them being, for example, Mystical Dispute could be a good option to just to focus mostly on other blue decks, or some other cards that like Whirlwind Denial, or maybe some other counter spells, even Neutralize, although I don't think Neutralize is better in this strategy. But I tend to play Didn't Say Please as just to have again a more focused game plan in order to make sure that most of our cards further our plan of milling the opponent. Didn't Say Please is a counter spell that will pretty much put 4 cards in the opponent's graveyard, which is a very strong number actually, because it mills for 3 plus plus the card that would be countered will also go to the graveyard, so it will be 4 in total, which is a very good number. That, for example, with only a Didn't Say Please and a landfall trigger from Ruined Crab, we will immediately have the 7 cards in the opponent's graveyard, which enables a lot of our cards like the Gargoyle and Into the Story, which would be a 4 mana draw 4 cards. Into the Story is a flexible slot in best of 1. I don't think it is in best of 3, it's a very powerful card, but in a more aggressive meta game, trimming a few numbers for this, for Into the Story, could be viable, because we don't want to draw too many in our opening hand and just fall too far behind against the aggressive meta game. So that's why we are running 3. It's still a very powerful option, but it's also a flexible slot that could be replaced with a card like Call of the Death Dweller. Call of the Death Dweller is also a nice card that pretty much gives us staying power and puts more of our creatures with enter the battlefield abilities like Thief's Guild Enforcer or Lurrus into the battlefield. So, and it's a bit cheaper and more consistent than Into the Story. But for now, I'm leaning towards Into the Story as the more powerful card. And since we are kind of falling in the mill strategy, I believe with this version we are not gonna have many situations where it's not gonna cost 4 mana. Finally, the Cling to Dust is a very important card in the Rogue strategy. It's great in most matchups right now, actually, even in best of 1. It's probably one of the best cards in the mirror, because it can exile the opponent's Cling to Dust and keep our graveyard thin, so the opponent's creatures and cards are much weaker compared to ours. Also, with every activation of Escape of Cling to Dust, we can actually thin our graveyard by 6 cards if we target a card in our own graveyard, which is a very big number. Also, it's very important to exile some Escape cards of the opponent's decks, like Kroxa mainly, or some people are running the Ox of Agonas, which is also a must exile card from the opponent's graveyard. Also, most mono red lists run at least 2 Phoenix of Ash, so again, Cling to Dust comes very handy there to be able to exile these recursive threats, because apart from that, we don't have any ways to directly exile the opponent's creatures, and we need to pretty much destroy them first and then exile them with Cling to Dust. And the worst case scenario just cycles for 1 mana, which is just almost a no cost for this deck. I would even consider playing 3, for example, going down to 2 Into the Story, or 3 Crabs and running 3 Cling to Dust. I wouldn't find it unreasonable at all. Finally, Lurrus as a companion works very well in this deck, just gives us a lot of grinding potential. And with 3 Agadims awakening out of the mana base, we can pretty much play a very strong grindy game by trading resources with the opponent and then get super ahead back with Agadim's Awakening. Also, the version we are running with 8 2 drops makes it more likely that we will use a maximum ability of the Awakening, especially if Lurrus is in the graveyard. We have higher chances than the lists that play only Soaring Thought Thief as their 2 drop to return 1 drop, 2 drop and 3 drop just with 1 activation of 1 cast of Agadim's Awakening. So, Rogues deck, very powerful. It would be the last tier 1 deck we are gonna talk about today. Very interesting for a more mid-range tempo-ish style of gameplay, but still very powerful. It's a bit easier to attack than other decks than Gruul and Mono Red, because they have very aggressive and straightforward game plan. The Rogue deck can be attacked by when the metagame has a lot of escape cards, which is most of the time the case right now. But Cling to Dust is just an amazing option to have against these cards. And if needed, we can increase the numbers of Cling to Dust whenever we feel it's really required. So that will do it for the tier 1 strategies that I consider pretty much any of these decks very viable to reach Mythic in a decent amount of time with a good win rate, as long as we become very very comfortable in piloting each of these decks. And now we are gonna move to the tier 2 decks, according to my opinion, which doesn't mean they are definitely strictly weaker than any of these decks, just I believe their average power level is a bit weaker, or they are a bit more easy to exploit by other strategies. But that doesn't mean that they are not super strong. I mean, I'm not gonna talk about any deck that is by any means mediocre. Here we are talking only about very strong strategies that could be viable choices for people to rank up quickly and enjoy also playing a very strong deck. So these decks we are going to talk now are also definitely fit that bill. The first one we are going to talk about is the deck we are going to play a few ranked matches later, which is Black-Red Kroxa. Now this is a deck that I really enjoy playing. It's a mid-range recursive strategy with sticky creatures pretty much. It can present a threat most of the time. It's a mid-range deck that can control the opponent's board with very powerful removal options and then have a good staying power with Liliana and the escape creatures. I like this strategy very much. The reason why I didn't put it as in the tier 1 category is because it's kind of soft to some other decks that go really over the top of it, like ramp strategies and Yorion decks, because we can't present a very good clock. So these really go over the top decks are really problematic for this type of strategy. But against the rest of the metagame, including all the other tier 1 decks, especially Rogues, I think this is a very viable option to be fighting them at least on even grounds and even being favored against, I believe, pretty much even all three of the tier 1 decks. This is a deck that pretty much wants to mill itself and start returning Kroxas as soon as possible while controlling the opponent's board with very powerful removal like Eliminate, Heartless Act, Bloodshift's Thirst and Bonecrusher Giant, and then empty the opponent's hands by returning Kroxa, casting Kroxa, and Liliana and Rankle. And after both us and the opponent are in top deck mode, then the escape cards just take over the game very quickly and close out the game as well. Now the main stake cards of this deck are Mire Triton, very important enabler as a 2-drop, then Timaret Calls the Dead, a card that holds the glue of the deck by filling our graveyard and also creating some threats for us to get on board. Then for the 4-drop slot we have a split of 2 Lilianas and 2 Rankle. Now Liliana I believe is stronger in this strategy for this deck. I would like to run even more if compared to Rankle, for example. I would like to go up to 3 Lilianas. However, Liliana is a Planeswalker and we want to have as high creature count as possible as well without having to exile an escape creature in order for Timaret Calls the Dead to almost always provide us a 2-2 zombie. The creature count of this deck is not extremely heavy if you don't count the escape creatures as well, which usually we don't want to be exiling to create a zombie. So having more copies of Liliana may create some awkward situations where we can't exile pretty much. We are gonna miss on creating a zombie, which is a huge downside actually. We want to be able to create 2 zombies very consistently with Timaret Calls the Dead. And that's why we are running a split of 2 Liliana and 2 Rankle. And then we run 2 Elspeth Nightmare, which I believe it's a kind of underrated card. I mean, it's not an unknown card. People have been playing it quite a bit. But I think it's a decent card that could see some more play. And it's also quite decent in the metagame for 2 or 3 reasons. First of all, most of the decks right now have a split between small creatures and non-creature spells. Even the control decks, which are mostly Yorion decks, most of the time they have cards like Charming Prince and Skyclave Apparition, so the first mode of Elspeth Nightmare can be relevant even in those matchups. And even the heavy aggressive decks have some important non-creature cards like Embercleave, for example, or some other removal. Notably, the second mode also can take one of the spell lands if we wish to, which is important actually. It's like taking a land almost, but yeah, I mean, most people are playing spell lands in their decks right now in one way or another, so the chance that the second chapter of the saga missing is much less likely now that that many people are playing spell lands. And finally, the third mode, exiling the opponent's graveyard, can be relevant in many cases. Like most decks right now have a recursive theme, like for example, Mono Red has Phoenix of Ash, Rogues has ways to return their graveyard with Lurrus and Agadim's Awakening. Of course, this deck has escape creatures which are very good to be exiled as well. So exiling the opponent's graveyard can be relevant as well. And also cycling, against cycling can be decent to empty their graveyard, so their Zenith Flare is less effective, although cycling not very popular right now, still it's a good thing to have in mind. The only question about this deck that I think is a flexible slot and really difficult to be filled in a proper way, I would say, is the Acquisition Expert. This is a card that we don't see so much, and there are another two different options that we could run as a two-drop creature that will complement the Mire Tritons. And these are... there are two options. One of them is Robber of the Rich, which is the choice that Paolo Vitor Damodarosa was playing in the League Weekend, which is a nice proactive threat, but not as powerful in a mid-range deck like this that... that has hard time to just close the game quickly. Pretty much Robber of the Rich fits much better in purely aggressive decks than mid-range decks like this, although definitely a viable option. And the second option that was used quite a bit in the beginning versions of the deck is Magmatic Channeler. Now, Magmatic Channeler is a good card. I used to run it myself. I think it's quite strong and helps the deck in many ways. It has 3 toughness, so it doesn't die to Bonecrusher Giant, and the discard ability helps us both in the when we are flooding in the late game and also filling our graveyard in the early game to return an escape card. Also, it's very good at putting escape cards in our graveyard, like putting a Kroxa into our graveyard on turn 3 and potentially returning on turn 4 is very good. So Magmatic Channeler, definitely a very strong option for this deck. However, the reason we are not running it is because it's a bit awkward to turn on its ability, which is having at least 4 instant or sorcery in the graveyard. Now, why is this awkward? There are 2 reasons. The first one is that we want to be exiling cards of our graveyard very frequently because we want to return our Kroxas and Toxophagonas. So sometimes, although we would prioritize on exiling lands and also some creatures, sometimes inevitably we will have to exile some spells as well, and then Magmatic Channeler would be much more difficult to be enabled to have the full 4 count. Also, we can't afford to run so many non-creature spells to turn on the Channeler, because if we decrease our creature count a lot, then Timaret calls the death becomes weaker, meaning that Timaret calls the deck requires pretty much enchantments and creatures, while Magmatic Channeler requires instants and sorcery. So there is a big conflict there. So pretty much the reason we don't run the Channeler is because it's very difficult to turn on its ability to be a 2-mana 4/4, which is a big part of the card as well. But it's really a valuable card, and it has a lot of uses both in the early and late game, so I could see being a very good option as well. But in this case, we are gonna run Acquisitions Expert, which is a card that has an effect when it enters the battlefield. It's just a 1/2 body, but it's a better Berglarat pretty much, and also a decent blocker. Like, we are very happy to chump block, even just chump blocking with this card to fill our graveyard after it has already taken one of the opponent's cards. And also helps the deck's plan quite a bit, which is pretty much play a game with the opponent in top deck mode. So many of our cards try to fill this role, like Acquisitions Expert, Kroxa, Elspeth Nightmare, Liliana and Rankle. All these cards are good at discarding cards from the opponent's hand, making us more likely that we reach a game state where both us and the opponent go into top deck mode. As we said, to sum up, this deck is very good against aggressive decks, I would say. Gruul, Mono Red, because we have Death Touch creature here, we have Kroxa as a recursive decal to deal threat, we have very good chip removal, so we can handle these matchups very well. And we are also very good against Rogues, due to having escape cards and chip removal. This is the matchup we are mostly happier to face. But on the other hand, this deck is very weak against other go-over-the-top decks like most Yorion strategies and Ram strategies, as well as we could struggle a bit against pretty much combo strategies where we can't interact so well, and also we don't have a fast enough clock to disrupt the opponent before they do their own game plan. Moving on to the second tier 2 deck that I really consider a viable choice. This is a mono-white Winnie deck. It's a combination of life gain plus plus Winnie strategy that Crokis kind of created an early version of it, and it has been popping up on ladder recently. This is the list I would start with playing with this mono white deck. As you see, it has some elements of life gain like Alcid, Speaker of Havens, four Daxos, which is a very good blocker as well as a life gain engine, and then some life gain payoffs like Heliod and Lurrus. Lurrus not exactly life gain payoff, but has lifelink, and also it can enable the life gain strategy by keep replaying small cards which can trigger Daxos or protect Lurrus itself or even gain life in the later game. So we have some life gain synergies, but also we have some aggressive game plan with cards like Luminar Caspirant, which is a card that works very well with when we play one drop on turn one. That's why we are running a higher number of one drops. And also Seasoned Hollowblade. Seasoned Hollowblade is a very sticky threat. It's good against Wraths, because Wraths are always a card that that this type of Winnie decks always have trouble with. But in this version, with a Seasoned Hollowblade plus the 4 Selfless Savior, we can make sure that we will have a board presence if the opponent has a Destroy All Creatures. And cards like Seasoned Hollowblade or any creature, pretty much as long as we can keep it protected, are very good carriers of a Maul of the Skyclaves, which is a payoff equipment. Very strong if we attach it on a creature that is difficult to be removed, like Seasoned Hollowblade. Can close out the game very quickly because it creates a big evasive threat that is difficult to raise. And it's even better if we can put it on a lifelink threat, making it really impossible for the opponent to raise us and gaining us a large amount of life. Maul of Skyclaves is a great target to put it on a card like Speaker of the Heavens, Alcid of Light's Bounty, Seasoned Hollowblade and cards like that. So we can get benefit from the keywords and or the indestructibility of Hollowblade plus the evasive power of Maul of the Skyclaves. Finally, we have one of the most powerful white cards in current standard, which is Skyclave Apparition. It can double as a removal spell. As always, we don't want to have to commit so many non-creature slots for removal, because we want to have a proactive focused game plan, and that's why cards like Skyclave Apparition can fill this role very well, because it's a body pretty much that can increase our devotion as well in case we need it for cards like Daxons and our Singleton Heliod, as well as act as a very flexible removal spell together with Giant Killer, which is also a creature, and then at the same time a removal spell for bigger creatures, exactly what this type of strategies want. And especially Giant Killer is a very potent threat against many of the powerful decks except Rogues. It's very good against Gruul, good against Mono Red, that it has targets like Anax and Bonecrusher Giant, very good against Black Red, which because it can deal with Kroxa and Bonecrusher Giant, so definitely a very nice option to run in our one drop slot. And then we mentioned about Lurrus returning power, just give the deck quite a bit of a late game stickiness. It also works very well with cards that can protect it from removal, like Alcid of Life Bounty and Selfless Savior. So these are very good interactions with Lurrus, plus it has lifelink and help the life gain theme of the deck. Finally, we run one of Heliod and one Linden. As we said, the life gain theme is not as strong in this deck, but still these are good cards to have access to. As we said, Heliod is kind of easy to be turned on as a creature in this deck, because every of our cards except our lands are permanents, so it's relatively easy to have 5 devotion. And Heliod itself can give lifelink to any of our creature that has, for example, a Maul of the Skyclaves, and create a threat that is very difficult to raise and also pad our life total. The mana base here very straightforward, 16 Plains and 4 Castle Ardenvale, but we also have 4 Kabira Takedown, which hopefully we don't need to use it as a land, but this is again a very nice flexibility to have when we are running an aggressive deck like this. We don't want to commit pretty much pure slots for just removal, that are just removal. This is can be a removal when we need and a land when we need, all but it will be tapped. So in any case, it's a very good inclusion. Just when we use it as a land, we are not very happy, you know, just playing a tap land in this aggressive deck. But sometimes we really need one additional land, and having the plateau would save us from having an unplayable hand pretty much. Also, the removal split of this card is also very strong because it's just a 2-mana instant speed removal spell that deals damage as according to the number of the creatures we have. And as we said, this is a very creature heavy deck and focuses on keeping some creatures on the battlefield by making them protection or indestructible. So we are trying to just maintain a board presence in order to make Kabira takedown stronger as well. And as you see, the total number of creatures we run is 33. So Kabira takedown can most of the time consistently kill the creatures we want to take care of. Last but not least, the last deck we are gonna talk about, which I consider again a tier 2 strategy but still very viable and strong, is this Yorion deck. We couldn't finish pretty much talking about a best of one metagame without including at least one Yorion deck. And in my opinion, this is the version I would be more inclined to run right now, rather than a straight blue-white Yorion or an Esper Doom Foretold build or some other builds that have been popping around. I think this is a more focused, proactive game plan of a Yorion strategy, and I believe it's kind of decently matched up against the other top decks that we talked before. This is pretty much a food deck with top end, with its top end being the classic Yorion duo, being Elspeth Conqueror's Death and Yorion itself. It has a food package with Gilded Goose, Trial of Crumbs and Wicked Wolf, which are very strong cards when they work together. They are very strong cards when these are very strong cards, but they require a bit of synergy, so they are much better when we draw them with some of the other cards as well. Like if we draw Wicked Wolf, we need to have at least one Gilded Goose or Trail of Crumbs, and of course Trail of Crumbs works again very well with the other two cards. So they are very, very powerful cards, but they require some synergy. So that's why we are also running a 60 card version instead of an 80 card Yorion list, in order to have Yorion as our companion as well. It's just the food synergies are much stronger in a 60 card than in an 80 card deck. But yes, if we can get the synergies going together, this is a very potent trio pretty much. So definitely a very good powerful plan to be implementing. And then the additional cards we have are cards that have some good effect when they enter the battlefield that also complement Yorion. These are Llanowar Visionary as an additional mana creature, Skyclave Apparition, as we said, one of the most powerful white cards in the current standard, and Charming Prince, which can help us loop with Yorion to get more enter the battlefield triggers. Also, it's an early drop to pretty much trade with one of the opponent's threats and pretty much control the battlefield for a while until we take over with our big spells. We are running also 4 Glass Casket as the removal of choice, which here is a bit weak because it's a sorcery speed removal, but it has Exile Clause together with a Skyclave Apparition, so we can exile some of the opponent's problematic permanents like Escape cards. And we can deal with some other smaller things with pretty much the deck has a good removal suit, as you see. It has Elspeth Conqueror's Death for bigger creatures, a Wolf and Glass Casket for smaller creatures, and Apparition for permanents in between. So definitely a nice mid-range strategy, but with a strong removal suit. And then the late game of it's a classic late game of a Yorion deck, like bouncing as many possible permanents as we can to create as much value as possible, and then Elspeth Conqueror's Death to return any of our high creature count that we have. This is just a 23 creature deck, which is much higher than the average Yorion deck, making Elspeth Conqueror's Death a bit stronger. And then our mana base, very straightforward and strong. We also run 4 spell lands here, 3 Maria's Call and 1 Symbiosis, which are very good in this strategy because this deck can produce a lot of mana, and the Maria Skull can be also a nice finisher, as it's a card also that most Yorion decks are running. Now this deck can be a very good option against other aggressive decks like Gruul and Mono Red, because these are decks where traditionally our removals are to their best, especially Wicked Wolf, but also Apparition, Glass Casket and Elspeth Conqueror's Death are very good against both Mono Red and Gruul. So we can control the board and really close out the game once we play the first Yorion, or just win with card advantage by Trail of Crumb. but we can also fight removal heavy decks with sticky threats like Wicked Wolf itself and Trail of Crumbs, which can provide us a lot of card advantage and staying power against decks that want to control our board. The deck that this that the Yorion decks traditionally have problem is the Rogues deck, because as you see this deck lacks any escape card pretty much, because they are pretty mediocre. The options for escape cards in this type of build are Arachnir and Elspeth Sun's Nemesis. Now I'm not really a big fan of these cards. They are very good against Rogues in general, but in the other matchups they are so weak. I mean, if you don't escape them from the graveyard by them being milled, they just feel so bad in any other matchup. So if you play a best of three version of this deck, I would definitely include some number of Arachnir and or Elspeth in the sideboard, but I'm not a very big fan to run them in best of one, unless for example the meta game becomes like hugely dominated by Rogues. So since we are not running these cards of course our odds in the game against Rogues drop pretty much. Also, we are playing at sorcery speed, which plays to their strength of the Rogue deck, making it a really bad matchup, but most Yorion decks have bad matchups for Rogues in any case. The last thing I want to talk about this deck is that there is a very decent option to run Vivien in a 5-drop slot, which is a very good, it's a decent card in this deck as well. I mean, you can do some very, first of all, creating 3-3s is a very good, it's a very good proactive plan that's good in many matchups, including Rogues. Also, you have the option of -2ing when you play a Yorion and then immediately putting a Wicked Wolf and bouncing it with Yorion, so dealing with two of the opponent's creatures. That's also a very powerful interaction. And in general, Vivien can be a very strong card. But in general, I believe still in the power of Elspeth Conquers Death, and of course we can't run so many slots in the 5-drop. And already running 3 Yorions and 3 Elspeth Conquers Death, I believe we would have to cut some of these to include some Vivien, instead of adding more. And although Elspeth Conquers Death is heinous against Rogues, I believe it's powerful enough to be and good enough in most other matchups that I think I will give it a notch over Vivien actually. But I could see having like an option to run Vivien, for example, run 2 Vivians and 2 of each 5 drops pretty much. And having a build like this, for example, with 2 Yorions, 2 Vivians and 2 Elspeth Conquers Death. So this could be a very viable option, but for the time being I'm gonna run just the 3 Elspeth Conquers Death and 3 Yorions. So that will do it for the 6 decks that I really believe are very good options and will be exploring in the upcoming season. We will be running most of them in a circular way, and we will decide which one to run according to how the metagame shifts as well. But these would be the 6 decks that I believe are very powerful options to produce good results in the upcoming season for best of 1.